Going up against Warriors Gaming Unity. This is part of the SCA, the Southeast Asia qualifiers. I'm Zambrella, joined by Moppax. How's it going, dude?
Hello out there, SCA Dota fans. They're comical. Tune up in Dota TV or hanging out with us over on the stream. I'm pretty pumped up, man. Warriors Gaming United, or Unity, rather. They're a new squad, you know. Only had two recent matches. Kind of peek at there, and then Tearing. Also, not active very much lately. Oh, they were the ones who actually had the... they were not crazy enough to pick a clock. Sorry, that was worse. Gotta get their matches straight. They've been a little bit more busy themselves. Oh no, it was Tearing. Clockwork. Okay, I'm getting my teams mixed up here. I just want to know who could potentially... That's all that matters to me right now.
Well, they have my vote for winners if they pick clock. Remaining. And they win with it.
They'll horrifically lose. They do, but, you know.
They'll have the moral victory. Team
pick. All right, well, this is looking a little bit better. Because taking a look at some of Tearing's recent drafts, they were taking things like Witch Doctor first when there wasn't Rift Spirit left in the pool. But things are apparently serious now, because now they're taking their Rift Spirit first. So I like this much better. Thank you. talking like 2 days ago, people. Like, don't think I'm crazy here. They ran a mid Darks here. I don't know. These guys are off the wall. Ready. then the Invoker line opener from Warriors Gaming is pretty solid, and now they still have a chance. Or let me see here. Like, if you really wanted, if you wanted like the mid PL and SEA, this might be the time to grab it because you know it'll be banned out.
I mean, Darkseers were being really popular, I think, for in the SEA region.
Yeah, it's super solid with Earth Spirit too. Iron Shell on top, of course. Always gonna be a fun time.
5-man vacuum into the kick.
Tier. Top tier Dota hero right there. There's also the Bat Rider. Pretty team dependent though. Like some teams favoring it much more than others and just like fully aware that there's no chance they'll get it. I like the PL.
Yeah. It's pretty good against the Invoker. So good.
Wow, that's a super solid pick too. All right, well,
pretty good stuff so far. They can play the vision game with the Beastmaster now, so.
Especially when you're on Radiant side, it's always nice to have that hawk up for like looking into those Roshan pits. Thinking you're not just gonna lose the game to a couple mid-game Roshans or something like that. So.
Yeah,
with the Beastmaster, they can kind of start to build around because now you start looking at heroes like the Vengeful Spirit. Any of those more mobile mids, like even the PL really, because like Boots of Traveler are just so handy when you have a Beastmaster on your team, the Ember Spirit. And then that Bounty Ban does come out. Somebody who's been making a lot of appearances in the first phase. Typically now it's been a lot of Vision 1 bans throughout the second phase too, and with both teams missing them, you might see that, especially for Warriors Gaming just because they have like the first pick out of it, so I don't know if they'd rather ban two position ones and snag up one of the better ones.
Yeah, the likes of Spectre and Juggernaut have been very popular recently.
Yeah, Spec. It's still a pretty shallow pool, right? It's like basically Spec, Juggernaut, Ember Spirit's a lot in the safe lane, so I guess you can consider him position one at this point. Sven, Juggernaut, Ember. It's pretty much, that's like it. That's like all the position ones.
The odd lone druid, maybe. But
exactly.
That's normally off lane as well.
Then it's like Slark if everything else is banned. But or an OD, but of course he's already banned first phase. This not a very a wide pool. Gyrocopter, I suppose, would be the other. A Viper ban only touched in SEA lately. No one else saying hi to the old Viper at all.
I guess he's like one of the heroes that's less susceptible to ganks in the mid lane.
Yeah, for sure. Like, especially with an Earth Spirit, because he just relies mostly on the right clicks. It's just the big slow. It's not like magic nukes or anything like that, but get right up in the Viper's face, so he can kind of turn it around on you if he sends the opportunity.
10 seconds remaining.
That Bat Rider ban as well. Pretty nice combo with the Quas Exort Invoker. Your lasso into Sunstrike. And speaking of which, their offlaner is still probably the biggest question mark for Warriors Gaming if they want to go into the the Faceless Void or the Ravage.
Oh, yeah. do like the idea of the Void, actually, for Warriors Gaming, just because they've already got two ranged heroes. This sets up the Sunstrike for the early... I kind of feel like if you're going to pick the Faceless Void, you have to have heroes that can make use of the Chrono, definitely during the early and the mid-game.
Well, there's that Darkseer. No, now. Also good with the Invoker.
I see this so often, like, just pick up a Nyx Assassin. Go mid-Nyx or something crazy. Three int heroes.
Yeah, it's true. Nyx is sick. Like, the way that he can combo break that Darkseer. Disruptor. I'm just taking a look, and Warriors Gaming just played a game they won, too. It was yesterday. Invoker, Darkseer, Lion. Okay, those are their three heroes. And their last two were a PA and a Doom. I actually wouldn't be surprised to see the Doom here. I think that's really solid. Mm-hmm. If we saw a PA, I would be pretty impressed.
Yeah, no, like, I'm down with that. It's really good with the Darkseer as well.
What the hell is happening? Okay, yeah, but now listen to the team they played against. It was a Beastmaster, an Earth Spirit, and a Disruptor.
And it wasn't tearing.
No. Getting a little freaky. If they pick either Jug or PL, things are getting weird here, man. Okay, at least Spectre's here to break the chain. But, I mean, that's a PA replacement. I mean, that was due. Like, we knew that was coming.
So tearing, they're looking for their mid laner and the safe laner now, and pretty much out of the safe lane as we were talking about Juggernaut. Juggernaut does pretty well against the Spectre as well. Like, Spectre just can't go 1v1 against him.
Yeah, that's easily. Probably almost definitely the Jug, I would say, just because it's also the Darkseer, right? The Iron Shell spam, and you actually have the Healing Ward.
One of the few heroes, the melee heroes anyway, that can deal with him pretty well, but I'm going to throw in a Windranger here, probably towards that mid lane to fight up against the Invoker.
Yeah, that's pretty solid, because right now it doesn't look like they have anyone come in. Like, maybe they'll go for an aggressive four, but with a Spectre, kind of imagining that Doom might be better with their lineup. Like, someone who's still a little bit greedy, but I don't think Invoker's going to die mid, but I don't think he's looking to really, like, through the lane, so the Windranger might be able to push that advantage. And maybe this means they won't be able to go greedy, right? Because they picked a really strong mid laner. So if they were thinking about a Doom, they might have to go back for something, but I don't think it was their initial game plan.
Yeah.
Might need like a, you know, kind of like a Dazzle kind of ish idea. Not so much anymore, but more along the lines of like maybe a Bane or. Ah, they're just going to ban the Doom as well. Well, there you go. Don't worry about it. Crystal Maiden would actually be pretty good here if that was something that they were into. That's a very team dependent thing.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think about all the, you know, maybe throw in something like a Oracle here maybe for Warriors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Oracle, Tusk, Nightstalker.
Nightstalker.
Radiant team pick. I like that. That's if you're still thinking the same idea as the Doom, Nightstalker's pretty close. He's not going to get as rich as a Doom, but he can still be pretty effective at just jungling right up to that 4-minute mark.
Yeah.
Come in and make his mark on the game, really.
Good old Lion Talon.
So what are we missing here then? So this would be our Jug pick then. Yeah.
It's interesting. They actually found out the Slog over the Juggernaut.
Yeah, it's a little bit similar. I think maybe just because the Slark would be better against the Spectre in the later game, in the sense that like you can steal a bunch of essence shifts because like how tanky the Spectre is, and then you can kind of go ham. Near the end of the game. It's also harder for the Lion to snag up, I think, is another good reason. They don't have, if they were already playing the Nightstalker as well, it's like, it's very difficult as a Nightstalker to control the Slark. He can generally get off the silence just through Dark Pack before you can get it on. It's pretty obvious when you're running in for it, and then, of course, once he's in Shadow Dance, you have nothing against him. Whereas Jug can't magically vanish into the air.
I feel like...
until he Omni-slashes.
Yeah. I don't know whether... they're taking their time about this pick. It might just be like discussing things, because I know a lot of teams, they might know what they're going to pick. They're just waiting. Mm-hmm. Discussing their lineup, just discussing their draft. What they're going to do. Key points.
I like the Windranger against the Spectre. Yeah. I mean, really, what other choice do you have? Okay.
Unless you're like looking to try something new out, like a Lunar or something. But...
yeah, that's true. Or even like a Core Avenge actually would have been pretty sick as well. They really just want to like push the tempo. Like if you want to go Sven or Drow, even Drow, like we've seen with three heroes lately and it's sick. Like Drow Windranger is such a combo with their ult.
Yeah, something I want to talk about is Terrain. They've kind of got like a semi-push lineup here. I mean, Beastmaster obviously good at pushing, Windranger, the Focus Fire can hit down towers, and Juggernaut as well. What the Warriors Gaming have to deal with that? I guess Darkseer does okay, and Invoker's got some spammable spells, but they don't have huge amounts of AoE.
Yeah, it's all about how much pressure they're going to be able to get on top of that Spectre. I think that might just decide this game, honestly. Because if they can still manage to snag up like that Phase Boots Urn, and even like parts of a drum, like just a Bracer or something, by, I don't know, level 7 or 8, then the first time you start seeing this push in the group up, the Hawk can come out and you can just punish so hard as they try and like retreat from the towers. It sets up so well for Invoker. Get all this vision over everybody, and he is going to be that Quas Exort as well.
Yep.
And yeah, I don't know. Honestly, Spectre is just like not that late game carry that she used to be. She's so formidable early on now if she just get a couple items up.
All right. So, looking at all about the early game for these teams then, how well their lanes go, that sort of thing. I'm guessing that's a standard lane. Yeah, it's going to have the standard, just a single off lane Beastmaster on his own. We can see Darkseer's managed to come down early. So down an Observer Ward. Don't know if that was spotted out. There's definitely some pings going on.
30 seconds to bottom.
Yeah, I think he probably did see. I don't know, judging by the way he was jumping in and out, you do get a nice vision line right there and there. So this is a pretty common ward just to give yourself vision but not block the camp. It's nice for a Darkseer too, because you don't really want to block this camp as a Darkseer. No, right? You want to be using it. It's not like a there's no enemy enchantress or something that you're concerned with coming in your lane and snagging up creeps there, so.
Alright. Looks like we might just have a standard 100-100 rune going both the way of the mid lanes, although Spectre has got the Spectral Dagger off, waiting up on the cliff. It's gonna throw it out, try and snag the rune. Has she done it in time? In fact, Windranger is still gonna be able to grab that though.
Oh, so, not... so close. That's a cheeky little play. I've seen that a couple times now.
Yeah.
But... it looks like they were probably thinking that was coming.
The Spectral Dagger is quite a high mana cost. It burns through like 2/3 of his mana pool. But I mean, it's well worth the risk reward, really. It's very unlikely that you're going to die just because you get that free movement over the cliff.
And now, Afu, this is actually one of my favorite combos, is the Darkseer and the Nightstalker, because once you get a couple levels in the Iron Shell, the Nightstalker can make a rotation bot, and even if you don't have like a real good kill potential, he can come and get an Iron Shell, and then he can farm up the hard camp. Top lane, there on top of Zaki. Tango out, though. Oh, they were like right in his face.
You'll be right. Yeah, this is going to be pretty hard for Spectre. I mean, Beastmaster and Earth Spirit together, pretty tanky. All but Venom already picked up on the Earth Spirit. He's going to be pretty annoying, and the ball slow as well. That's some pretty decent sort of slow damage over time.
Yeah, it's not the craziest Beastmaster game. Against the Spectre, it's pretty good. A lot of Beastmasters having some times against a lot of the Ursa picks lately. Obviously, like, kiting him around during the team fights. Spectre, a little bit harder to deal with. Like, base boots, obviously the going over the terrain through the Spectral Dagger. Going from haunt to haunt, and hopping on top of people ahead of the Fusil Blade. Even just like the Manta, there's a lot of tools that Spectre gets that is a lot better than your typical melee core versus the Beastmaster. Zaki. Man, he's just really taking a beat here. Is the boar still gonna be enough? Man, he's got the 10 lockdown. Get all these juke spots going.
I check the stream. The quality seems really bad for some reason. I don't know why. Strange. Oh no, that's fine. No, ignore me. I've got the video quality set to medium. It's all good.
Well, nothing happening too much yet. It seems unlikely. I guess if the Earth Spirit shows up in the mid, could easily be a kill for the Windranger. No points into that Wex yet, of course. Sexort, so there's no Ghost Walk escape. Nice, he's prepping up for it here. He's got the Arcane.
Oh, nice Shackles! It's gonna land! Makes the Roll Boulder easy to hit, but he doesn't even hit it! The Slows are coming out, though. Summons the Forge Spirit. Could be enough to force them back, although a Stray Power Shot, 200 damage, would not be enough. Invoker eats a tree. He's got the regen from the Quas as well.
That was pretty sick. He saw that roll coming in. Like, he didn't even have vision of setting up the roll. Quick juke back and forward.
Yeah.
Or else I'm sure he probably would have been dead.
Yeah, if that Rolling Boulder had hit, that definitely would have, in the death of Invoker. He's now gonna plant his own tree down and get aggressive on Windranger, but Windranger of course has that wind run.
Afu's got boots on bottom too, so he's starting to really start push back this disruptor. Let's support.
Oh, the Zaki's gonna get gone on here. It's a great stun though, catching out two of the heroes in one. However, Lion's still gonna go down. JNY is gonna be the person to pick that up on the Beastmaster.
Yeah, this is good, right? This is the exact dual offing that I wanted to see. Like, a lot of pressure up here. Keep killing that support and see, just in the farm though. Spectre. I managed to get these last hits. That'll get harder as the Beastmaster gets up in levels though.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even mind seeing like the Disruptor come up here at some point, like probably in the next 2 or 3 minutes, and try and go for a kill.
Yeah, I mean, that does leave Juggernaut on his own, but he can catch up pretty easily, to be honest. Like, if he doesn't have a great start. But here comes another Rolling Boulder. It's actually going to go in between the two of them. Split right there, but the Disruptor going to bring back the Night Stalker. They're going to throw out a few more right clicks. The Body Blocks come in from Ice there, and they're going to get themselves a second kill for Tearing.
I guess I know why they picked Witch Doctor first the other time. No, I'm not quite getting the lucky rolls and the kicks here. Don't worry, I still get the hang of it. I'm scared into it. Getting warmed up.
I mean, that was kind of unlucky, I think, to be honest. Like,
yeah, no, it was a tough hit. I'm just kidding.
Missing bottom.
But yeah, it's definitely like one of those heroes. Like, maybe if you haven't played him for a few days or something. You just gotta get back into the swing of things, or the roll of things.
There you go. Now you gotta get rocking and rolling. Is that what it is?
Yeah, you just gotta get in character.
He's only level 3 on Afu, so not exactly the ideal Night Stalker, considering we're up to almost the 5-minute mark, but it is just because he was applying a lot of the pressure down bottom. So, it doesn't look like he's gonna have much of an impact in this mid lane, honestly. They could try some sort of cold snap play, but you can see he just doesn't even bother. So yeah, this isn't gonna...
He is, like you said, level 3. But I guess he just puts down the sentry straight as the Observer Ward gets put down.
He's gonna get the Invoker. Yeah. What a good guy.
Oh, double the regen now for Invoker. Beautiful.
So thoughtful. They must be like best friends or something. No? Yeah. Giving him that gold. I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do that for you.
No. Thanks. That's quite alright. You don't know me.
True.
This is our first time casting together. Exciting.
Oh, it's rather thrilling. Don't you worry.
Man, this Earth Spirit is everywhere. I always see them, like, Earth Spirits always have the most effect. I feel like they're the most effective when they're just everywhere in the map. Always pressuring all the other lanes, and like, kind of like when they're missing, they're also being effective because they're like, where's the Earth Spirit? Am I going to get rolled on here? Night Stalker, they're going to fight the kick away, but it's not really going to do anything. Night Stalker going to save that. Actually, no, he's going to pick it up for himself. Head up towards this top lane once again. But Beastmaster is more than aware of
this. He should be running by now, I think.
Really? Really? He's not running at the moment. Lion's going to go for the wraparound. Night Stalker throws out the Void. It's got reduced cooldown as well. The Roar onto the line. The Rolling Boulder misses once again, but the kick is going to catch the two of the heroes. They just turn and kill the Lion. Beastmaster knew that he could do this, and in comes the Windrunner. Does have the Shackle shot. Latches onto the Spectre. The Sunstrike is going to net the kill on the Beastmaster, but it's a 2-for-1 trade now.
Alright, that works. Yeah, that would have been probably even better if they got the roll too. But a nice little play.
Yeah,
life will be all good, and they finally got that Spectre. That's the big one.
They almost got out if the Invoker hadn't got the Sunstrike, which, you know, not the easiest spell to land. Would have been a 2-for-0.
Notice the Hero Spirit got both kills. Sitting on 800 gold, he's rich all of a sudden.
I mean, they're
going for that
boots.
Or Arcane Boots too, whatever he wants, really.
Scroll. He must be everywhere. Oh, he's got Silence up. Did manage to kick the Night Stalker away. That might have saved him. The slow is going to come through. The Sunstrike off the mark. Is he going to try and roll himself away? It doesn't matter. Finally, the pesky Earth Spirit is destroyed. Night Stalker is going to be the one picking up the kill, unfortunately. Not the Spectre for Warriors Gaming.
Still needs a little bit of catch up. And in the mid lane with Windranger gone, Invoker, you can see, has gotten to the top of the last hit start and getting a lot of pressure on that mid lane. No damage to his own tower, just about 30, and Windranger taking quite a beating there, so they're hoping to open up the map a little bit, get that down, and it's gonna be really big for the next night time. By then, that's when you're really gonna want to be seeing that. The Iron Talon did come out for your night soccer, so it's going to be AFK for most of the daytime. Probably just going to make some rotations in with Iron Shell, possibly, but mostly just farm up.
Yep.
Got to get those levels.
Dragonlord Squad is, well, he's level 7 now, so he's got the Omni Slash, so...
Look at the last.
So it does have to be careful. They're actually lasting equally, it's kind of insane.
Yeah, he's having a very good time down there. Be pretty happy with that. How was the Dax here? But yeah, that is a good point, though, because it's not as much shutdown as that you'd like. And that's the power of the Juggernaut, is that he's not really pressured by the Iron Shell. Like, you can see he's actually gone for 2 points in the early board.
Points in crit. So, you know, that's one of the great things about Juggernaut. You can just be so flexible with his skill build. Meanwhile, in this top lane, though, the pressure being applied, it looks like they managed to pull the Dire creep wave into this neutral camp, the little pull camp for the tower. Gonna get some pressure on it, get some damage in. Is kind of like, guys, I need some help here.
Yeah, that's a really good time for them to pressure. It's daytime. The Invoker, you know, he's going to be going for the Midas, and he did just grab it, but of course, that means that that's his only item, and it's only a farming item, so really to come up there and contest. Windranger's applying the same pressure in the mid lane. Going to have her ultimate, the Focus Fire, up and ready so they can really start to knock down these towers and not just pressure them. So if she wants to make a rotation top, like, she gets one good rune, be good come the but it looks like she's just gonna head on up there, and I think they're gonna take that tower.
Yeah, why not?
It's a nice ward too. Vector. Gonna need a little bit of Peckle, might have to go up. She's scary.
That's right. That ward, very handy.
So now how are they gonna apply the counter pressure though? It looks like it should be in the mid lane just because how weak the tower is. And they do know everyone's up there. I'm surprised they're not just like nuking this wave, honestly, but instead they're gonna try and smoke up. Lion and the Night Stalker. Down bottom. It's pretty sneaky.
Three Raiden heroes though, so it could be a 3v3 fight. There is an Omni Slash Disruptor, isn't level 6 yet though. They're gonna roll, try and catch out with a hit towards. I don't mean to be mean when I say that, but the Omni Slash comes through, the wall is put down, the Spectre Horn comes in. It's a 4v3 now on the Raiden, they just need to get themselves out of there. The Sunstrike gonna come down, it hits on Juggernaut perfectly. Now the stun coming in from the Lion, the third kill. They're looking for it on the Earth Spirit. He's got the roll, gonna get himself to safety, moving through the tree line. But oh no, he's gonna be trapped in there, he doesn't have a Tango. Oh, he's hiding. They want to try and find him, but he is in a little crevice.
Oh, no, the illusion.
They can't see him. The Iron Talon.
Oh, it went out.
Oh, he's got Rolling Boulder in 1 second. He's going to make it. He's fine. Oh, he's out scot-free. Oh, I say scot-free. Two of his teammates died. Meanwhile, in the top lane, though, Beastmaster does continue to pressure the top lane.
Alright, well, that was kind of a case of the Radiant trying to be a little bit sneaky. Like, they show everyone top, and then the supports back up and TP right behind the tower. Dark's here baiting out that gank there. I'm sure he was well aware of the rotation had been, considering they went off the top there and into the bottom, but support rotation coming from the line and the Night Stalker. And that was a really, like, crazy decision, kind of, because I think most teams would have done that pressure mid. Brought everybody in and kept, like, beating down that tower, but they get a much more favorable trade in the bottom.
It was there, because Darkseer, just being so, like, the net worth he has and the items, the buckler, giving them the extra armor just to be able to survive that, put down the wall, which made a big difference, and survived the gank.
Yeah, now he's got the up and running. Yeah, I can't believe he didn't die. He was down to, like, 60 HP or something. He was way down there. Alright, well, there's your phase earn at 12 minutes. Too bad. You know, not ideal. A little behind that juggernaut.
I mean, considering how much pressure was there, like, 55 CS at this stage of the game isn't the worst in the world.
Oh, no, yeah. Considering the situation, she's doing great.
Top of the net worth is that Invoker. Now with drums complete as well. Guess he'll be looking to go for, like, a Yule's next.
Yeah, probably. It's pretty player preference. Like, people are still really into just, like, the Aghanims right after the drums and then just going for the Yules, or the Blink Dagger, rather. And other people are more into the Yules. There is the Disruptor, so that would be a pretty good reason to go Yules, honestly, just in case you do get locked into these early Static Storms.
Oh, the Earthquake gets the kicks. The Juggernaut, he was thinking about coming in here, but now with the Spectre haunting in, Disruptor does have that ultimate. The Static Storm connect feels not going to connect on anyone. The Omni Slash hits Spectre, but Spectre just moves through the tree line. The Shackle Shot comes through, doesn't connect on the Invoker. He moves just a bit too far away from the Lion. Now they're on the retreat, tearing. They need to get themselves back towards the T1. The Silence, but that finger. Lion, long range. Finger of Death, and that's them the second kill, and the second of the, well, the second kill being the most important onto that mid laner.
I had to check to make sure he didn't have Aether Blitz.
Yeah.
That thing was flying. Cute little play by the Disruptor as well, running away, almost died to Forge Spirits, but popped the smoke. Sure they wouldn't be able to kill him. So that was kind of nice, and we'll make himself away, but on the wind range is great, and oh, heading in near Roshan. They're gonna have the Forge Spirits, they have the Alacrity. Mm-hmm. I think that they can go for it soon, but I would wait till I had Haunt up. That would be really big for them. They already get such a cash infusion of that big fight bottom, and now they just won another one, and this is exactly what you need on this lineup, because they're just gonna scale so well.
Yeah, they're definitely gonna go for this. They've got the vacuum. It's level 2 vacuum, they're already as well. It is night time, so vision reduced pairing. Lion's just sitting on the outside, the ball's gonna go in, see what's going on. Juggernaut his, however, in the top lane, and no TP. I don't think there's any way they're gonna be able to contest this Roshan. It's falling fairly slowly. They got a bit of vision with the power shot. The Hawk's coming in. It's gonna get destroyed. No, it's not gonna get destroyed. They have no vision. It's down to 300 hit points. Roshan is gonna fall. Gonna be picked up by the Invoker. And now the Radiant Dire even moving inside the Radiant Jungle. Beastmaster does have the Roar, but he's in a dangerous position. Throws out the Roar. The Sunstrike's gonna come down. Beastmaster is a goner. And all committed at the last second, just in case the Shackle onto the line, and then...
Yeah.
Glimpse back. That was a bit risky from Taryn to stick around after Roshan got taken.
Yeah, that was a kind of interesting play, right? Like, you'd think they didn't get much out of the map, only really your Juggernaut there, able to keep pressuring top, so I think he made the right move. In which he is immune once, yeah, so he has nothing to counter his spin TP right now, which is pretty great. So with the phase boost, the drums being pretty mobile around the map, if he wants to get into that Battle Fury, he should have a pretty good time doing it. He can use a lot of the map just with like those two tier ones down. He can kind of farm this whole expanse, and every time he's in trouble he can just spin.
Yep,
to watch that Night Stalker running in with like the silence, I suppose. Is under attack. Excited to see this Wind Ranger build. Going for that Maelstrom, a little bit more old school. Oh, it's actually the Hand of Midas. Oh, wow. Okay, even more old school.
Okay.
Nice. Gonna propel himself yeah. into that Aghanim Scepter. Oh, I don't know. This is pretty risky. Yeah, the pressure is coming. Every single time Haunt's off cooldown, they're smoking up, they're running in. It's nighttime right now. I don't know if they'll have a chance to make use of it. Yeah, they're gonna smoke up right now. They're just gonna make sure there's no ward. And Haunt is just... I don't know, this hero is just... completely different.
Yeah.
It's just not at all what it used to be. It used to be like, she would Haunt in during the fights early on, but it was only for the assist gold. She wasn't like a big part of it. But you can see phase, drums, urn. Deals a lot of damage.
Those smoke. A little fair bit of time left on it. Three heroes sticking together. Who are they going to be able to find to put down themselves? What? They see the Earth Spirit. I think that's all they're going to be able to get from this. There's no... the Hex is going to be in range. It is. He just tried to go the Rolling Boulder, but... just a little bit too slow. Beastmaster! Okay, this is not the way you want to be, my friend, JNY. Finger comes out once again from the line. The Shackles onto the Invoker, but they're going in one by one here. Probably not the best idea. This is against the Spectre. This is against the Nightstalker, where it's nighttime at the moment. As Windranger is going to be possibly the fourth death now for Taryng. They're chasing. She's pretty speedy. Got the wind run up now. Gets behind her T2 tower in the mid lane. That was definitely some, attack. I think, a misplay from Taryng. Like, understandable losing the Earth Spirit. But then the TP in from the Beastmaster to the T1.
Yeah, mistakes were made. There definitely should have been a back call there. Radiant structures are fortified. There's no way you should be losing this. The pressure, man. It is real. I mean, I gotta say, I was a little bit worried for Taryng coming in just by, like, some of the drafting and some of the heroes they've been picking recently, and it does look like they're getting a little bit outclassed here throughout this mid-game. Like, the farm, it's coming in much stronger over on Warriors Gaming. Looks like they're trying to make something happen here, or this is just the most defensive posture ever. They have the smoke on the Earth Spirit, but... wow, an Atos!
Interesting.
That is interesting.
So it makes landing the Sunstrikes a little easier.
I've seen it against like Ursas for some of the Invokers for when they get a nice little early lead, but a little bit surprised on this game. It's okay against the Jug, but of course having the spin, you know, one of those things, he's almost certainly going to build into a Mantle later on.
Arguably ineffective against the Windranger as well. Actually, no, that's not true. It's not a flat move speed, is it? So, Windranger is going to get hexed up here. Did get Atos. Meteor's going to come for her, and she's just going to die.
Yeah, I guess it's just like a preference thing, whereas he would rather stay further back than like... Like, the blink allows you to kind of cover the same distance, but you don't have to go there yourself.
Kakarot's moving up towards the north, but he's going to run into the Spectre and just spin TP out of there. And actually, everyone from Tearing is going to be able to get out.
Well, losing this Windranger again, though. That Midas. Not having a very good time.
0-2.
Thank you.
Networth, where is it? Yeah, Networth, middle of the road at the moment. But it's the overall picture. WG. Warriors Gaming Unity. They're currently just under 7.5k net worth ahead of the enemy Radiant team. And their experience very similar there. Stalker using that darkness, looking, trying to find someone. Ranger does not want to die again. I think the Radiant, they're going to just try and... Looks like they're kind of split pushing at the moment. The Rolling Boulder is going to come through, but it doesn't hit on the Spectre. Now up to 1400 gold. That's the Aegis timing out. Or was the Aegis even used? Nope.
No, you're right. It's faded on the invoke.
I think I saw that was a 5-minute respawn, so a fairly long one. I think Terran doing the right thing. There's no way they can defend this bottom tower at this stage of the game. Considering where they are, so they're just going to split push, take this top tower, which is now down to 1,000 hit points. Mid lane is being pressured as well. Who's coming back? This is Lion already coming back, but he's got this Blink Dagger now. It's going to be spotted out by the Hawk. Now he blinks forward, gets the Hex, and now the Spectre Horn coming. The Static Storm is going to be there to protect Juggernaut, but it's not going to work out. So Disruptor tries, but does manage to get the Glimpse out, but the Finger. Lion is just destroying people. You never get bored of that spell.
Oh, it's very flashy, isn't it? Thank goodness. I don't know, their movements have been so crisp.
They're utilizing the Spectre really well.
Yeah, every time they need that haunt, it's on cooldown. It's just like, every time they make a move where the haunt will be good, they're making sure they're gonna have it available. Master runs into the Spectre with the Necros, body blocked in, no mana for a dagger.
Possibly do this. The drum is going to be used. He's got an urn, but that's not really going to help him when he's actually taking damage.
Life right now.
Going for it. He's trying. Getting blocked up actually by his own creeps there.
No!
It was a tricky kill, and he nearly had it as well.
He should have had the body block anyway, I feel like, in here, but... Well... Bad life. Middle
tower is under attack. What level Necro is it? Only 11 Necro 2. If only he had the Necro 3, that would have been definitely a kill.
Yeah.
I mean, it's surprising how much damage you can do with the Beastmaster on a solo target with the maxed out inner beast.
That's like it's crazy. Necro Necro 3 is an Radiant's inner beast max. Tower is under attack. I think he even uses act. Radiant's kind of pointless at this point.
Yeah.
Alright, what do we got here? We got our Greaves, so general game plan here is just going to be fire him up a little bit, wait for the Aegis. Actually, there's still tier 2s. I wouldn't mind them just going for the tier 2s without the Aegis, frankly, and then just take it from the high ground, because they're just walking as a unit, and the only way Terran get back in this game is smoking up with the Hawk, using that as, like, forward vision and getting glimpses or that as, you know, as, like, solo target they're leaving. But if they glimpse a single person from this little pack that's been roaming around the map, they're just going to turn on them.
Yep. Juggernaut looks like he's gonna try and move in on this Darkseer. Spectre does have the Haunt up though, so they can maybe turn around. Darkseer's gonna run himself away from the creep wave. Maybe just a little bit too fast. Nightstalker gonna use that ultimate in the bottom lane. Windranger gets picked up once again. I'm guessing that was Lion blinking forward, doing the stuns, and then Oka getting the damage out with his spells.
This is still okay, wow. Alright. Yamato have been farming like crazy. Props to that. Sorry, after the point boost of the Overclub, it's half a wizardry, so not quite there, but way further than I was expecting. This gem by ice, this is the comeback item.
Yeah, it does definitely give your team maybe an semblance of map control.
Yeah, they just need it so bad though, like... They can't afford this kind of vision, like this and this, because it just allows that whenever Spectre wants, or it can just be a Nightstalker running around, like seeing one target, and he can just and then just haunt, and they're going to be able to kill you. And it could be a very major target.
His wards are actually like about to time out, though. This is kind of upsetting.
Yeah.
Got that one ward though here. Windranger's got to be really careful here again. The blink forward, she's going to get hexed up once again. Now the stun, she is a bit further away than she was before. Now the rolling boulder is going to come through, but the finger is there, and Yamate dead once again. And now Earthbearer in a lot of trouble. The Spectre dagger is going to go through on 60 hit points now. Spectre does get roared off. Tornado coming through and stopping a lot of the damage. The Omni Slash bounces to Archie Invoker. They wanted on the Spectre, but Spectre trapped out by the Static Storm. Invoker's just going to invisibility himself up and TP out of there. But they get the kill on the Spectre.
And yeah, for the first time, overextending.
Yeah.
Get punished.
So, score 5-15 now. This game is definitely going the way of WG Unity. 12k net worth lead. That is a sizable lead. Roshan will be spawning in about a minute.
I don't know, this is pretty scary. Nothing at all. Not so much. I'll just have to hope that they can get maybe a favorable Necro death. A big magnetize. I don't know. Still only level 7. Pretty difficult game there on the Earth Spirit. Not able to get up into some of those bigger support levels.
In all honesty, like, what is Taryn's game plan? Is it just try and get pick-offs with the Beastmaster? And like take, you know, objectives from there, maybe just try and get a big kill on say the Invoker or the Spectre, like a good roar or something.
Yeah, it feels like it would probably be a good time to, you know, try and head up, like knowing the Haunt's on cooldown. Yes, it's nighttime, yes, it's still scary, but you have to make something happen, because the longer you just delay, once Roshan's up, which is going to be just now, That's gonna be the new battleground, and they just have nothing to fight there. Besides the Hawk, it's favorable, but like, I don't think this Disruptor can even get in for Static Storm.
Yeah. And Roshan has respawned Radiant on the wrong side of the map at the moment if they want to try and take that. Looks like they're trying to maybe think about catching out the Darkseer, but he's just hiding for now as Invoker moves inside the Roshan pit. He's gonna start taking down Alacrity plus Forge Spirits. Lion can come in with some stuns. This is a lot of damage on Roshan. Booker's hitting pretty damn hard with that Alacrity. He'll be up again in 4 seconds. And in comes the Nightstalker, Spectre. They're coming in and help them. In fact, they're all down here. And I don't think there's any answer from Tearing.
No, Afu was just like, just in the end of that last nighttime, he's just wandering around. Like, he spots the Roshan, so the Invoker's gonna hit him, and he just does this big loop with the Aghanim Scepter and the gem. And they just know, they have total control over this area. And it's just such an amazing power to bring Nightstalker into your lineup and that game control, even just mid game control. 25 minutes, all he has is an Aghanim Scepter and a gem, but it's so strong. Dire's
top tower is there, under Roshan is gonna go the way of the Dire once again, and Invoker's gonna pick it up for the second time now. And he gets him some blink after getting the Aghanim Scepter, so he doesn't need the Lion to initiate for him anymore. Sunstrike, I saw.
He is so insanely rich. He's almost double. Oh, not so much anymore. Now the Aghanim Scepter's there, I suppose, but he's still 5k up of his counterpart, you know, in the mid game. Or in the mid lane, rather. I feel like he's feeling pretty happy about that.
Yeah. I'm talking about went for the blink after the on the Battle Fury.
That's pretty good, right? It's gonna help him that farming out on the outside part of the lanes. It's also nice during the high ground defense that you're gonna blink over and try and get into the back line, namely just try and bring down Zaki, who would be cool, because clearly no stat items, pretty typical Lion build. Some boots into a blink dagger, he's got like a magic wand, those are his stats, so.
Oh, the smoke plus the Nightstalker, they're just gonna jump and try and blow off the Windranger, which they will succeed. They're chasing for more though, the Sion is onto the Disruptor, the vacuum up the wall, catching up to the Roar is there just as a defense, but it's not gonna be enough. The Tornado plus the EMP is gonna put down, invoke a level 17, putting the Wex to effect. And 4 dead on Tearing side. Juggernaut wasn't dead because he was on the top lane. But had he been with his team, I'm sure it would have been a 5-man wipe. Just so quick from WG Unity there.
They're just so far ahead. Like 12k, 27 minutes. The fact that it's also a lineup with the Invoker. Like, the Invoker is just so insanely farmed as well. And a beautiful vacuum. Gotta give some props into that.
Yeah.
Nice.
That's gonna go off on the high ground now. Rotation's gonna buy them some time. I think Tearing, they'll be back to defend their racks. Beastmaster up in 8 seconds, but he's got no roar for 30 seconds. There is still the Static Storm available, so Tornado flies through the Sunstrike as well. This is gonna do so much damage, Disruptor just dies! Invoker. He knows how to play this here with the blink forward from Yamate. Can't find anyone. Aegis on him now. Throws out a power shot as the tower is just gonna get denied. Inrain just like, you're not gonna get this. But down to disruptor for 20 seconds. Can Tearing hold this high ground as nighttime? 28 minutes in. And there's the Aegis. Still up for another, actually quite a while, another 2.5 minutes, so. No, like, a big time period now, and then the tornado, the ice wall as well. Invoker using all his spells available to him. Earth Spirit silenced up at the moment. The blink forward from Lion, they're gonna try and blow him up. The vacuum, it's enough. They grab him, now the Shackle catches that Invoker member here. Remember, he's got the Aegis. Shot it back up, he's got the Static Storm. Beastmaster still got Roar, level 3 Necro Burst, and now the blink forward, the spin from the Juggernaut, just trying to push back the enemy. They are relentless. Melee Barracks down to about a third health. Now the Blink Four, they're gonna get tracked out. The Wind Rangers, he's still alive. The Static Storm catches a couple of heroes now. Now the Omni Slash. No Dark Seer, so no, I don't even he actually did have Wall up, but the Melee Barracks is out. They glimpse back the Night Storm, he's still alive. The Sunstrike not getting anyone. It's a great shackle there from Yamate. Just catching the Night Stalker. So two dead from WG Unity, and they want to try and get out of here, but Ice, he's looking for more. He rolls on forward. If they can get more, that would be great. But Invoker's actually sticking around. Gonna turn on the Earth Spirit and burn all his mana with the EMP.
Well, they got what they came for. It didn't cost them any buybacks on the side of Tearing though, so they can be a little bit happy about that. They certainly got some gold. It seems like the melee racks were definitely dead no matter what. Like, you might even have to get a couple buybacks just to try and save the rest of your base, so that pretty well. They're just still so far on the back foot, though.
What does Juggernaut go for next? Does he think, with the Blink Dagger, it kind of makes the Abyssal Blade really good. So, maybe a Bastion next.
Yeah, for sure. Like, that's definitely one of the better options for him. Some people might go for a BKB as well, just because, like, it's frustrating as a Jug to have to go that, but it's also a Lion, the Darkseer, the Nightstalker, Invoker. Still seems like if he actually wants to kill the Invoker, I don't know if he'd be able to with an Abyssal Blade simply because you won't be able to get the damage out there if you're spinning, and everyone's just gonna show up with Nightstalker and Lion.
We'll see. Beastmaster gets his Blink now, so that's probably there, one of the best forms of initiation now. Especially if they do smoke up and gank to try and find someone.
They need to find this Invoker. Like, he actually would be so much gold right now.
Oh my god, he hasn't even died. 9-0-6.
Having that Aegis it's gonna time me out, so if they have a good timer, man, if they smoke up right now, it would be so solid for them.
Got one on the disruptor.
Yeah.
There's one on Earth Spirit as well, actually.
The supports are just following Invoker everywhere, though, they know.
VG playing this really well at the moment. Looks like they are. They're definitely thinking about smoke. Ow. Leading with the Hawk. Meanwhile, the bottom lane getting pushed in by the Lion and Invoker. You're right, this Lion is just sticking by the Invoker, and the Nightstalker is not too far away either. He gets his own Blink Dagger.
Like, I'm actually surprised he's not closer, because looking at the map, they don't have any vision as to where the entirety of the Radiant side are, and definitely be full aware that it is going to be an Invoker. The main target is, and they're trying to just make this like bastion of hope. No, the entire Radiant side just like filling up there, not even their base, you know, just hoping that some one or two members maybe are going to be smoking in there or just making their way around, feeling all nice and safe, and they'll actually get a free pick off. But so blades out.
Oh, with the banter as well.
Oh, it's so sad.
They're having hard enough time killing off the Invoker. They're getting the Spectre as well. Invisibility. KB picked up a Wind Ranger, so I guess that means she can kind of, if she does get a good Shackle, she can actually just turn on the BKB and the Focus Fire and maybe bring down the Invoker. Invoker doesn't have only with 9 armor.
Yeah, the BKB was a necessity.
But there's a potential for Wind Ranger to possibly find a kill there. Invoker's got his own BKB now.
They're gonna smoke up. 5k now up on that Juggernaut, so whatever he's gonna buy. Get a relative idea soon. It's not doing him any favors right now sitting in his bank, and they need everything.
It's gonna be
when it comes to just waves and potential ganks. I really think he needs to start. Is he just gonna go for the butterfly?
Scardy.
I really hope
no,
so.
No, he's going, he's going Scardy.
I don't think it's a good item, but I think he.
It's a Scardy because he got all the venom on the courier. There we go.
I don't like that either, but.
Tanks up, and they're gonna get the shackle onto the Darkseid. Darkseid, he's so tanky though. He's got the Vanguard plus the Guardian Greaves. He's just survived through all of it. The BKB comes out from the wind range, but they can't kill him. They do finally. Vacuum comes out, but the two are already dead on Tearing side. The BKB starting to wear out from wind range. The shackle onto the Illusion catches up the Spectre. They need to go for the Omni Slash. They grab the Spectre. Spectre can't survive through all of this. He walks towards his team. Not gonna help. And
oh,
Spectre
is
dead. Is this the fight? And now Invoker goes in, but do they have detection? Doesn't matter. They get him anyway. They did have detection from the Necronomicon unit, and now the Shackle catches out Lion. Four dead on WG Unity. A triple kill for Yamate on the Wind Ranger.
What happened with the Invoker? He just like ran in.
I don't know.
Oh man.
That was
Things
insane.
Yamate, he must have cleaned up like 3k or something. I don't even know. 470, 1200. Another. Oh god, he actually got over 2k from that fight.
That is ridiculous, and now the pressure they can apply down this mid lane. No pipe, actually. I just wanted, they're probably just going to give up the tower, and I don't know whether Terry can go any further forward. Roshan, it'd be great if Roshan respawned now, but it's not up for another over minute and a half now, actually.
Wow.
We had to get this T1 tower in the bottom lane. That'll fall now. Yoink. Dire's bottom tower has fallen. Oh man.
A little bit of a misstep there, I suppose. They've looked so invulnerable this whole game, I'm still like in shock that they actually died.
But look at Wind Ranger's net worth now.
Yeah, it's insane.
4k above the Spectre. Where did she get this gold from? Oh, the fight, clearly. But even though she keeps dying, she's actually been able to farm really well throughout the game. Or at least decently, to maintain this net worth.
Yeah, there have been so many moments where I just like look at her inventory and I'm like, where did that come from? Midas paying off, but also just a job getting those right clicks around the map. 200 CS, I mean, pretty respectable. It's not quite up to her Juggernaut, but gets a little bit more freedom. Oh, this is great. Like, the Scotty, I gotta say, I wasn't a really big fan of it, but it worked out. He didn't get punished at all by the Lion. He wasn't caught out by any sort of spells for that entire fight, which means he gets another massive infusion, and then he can go into some other items and. That's for Scotty. Okay. Like, he'll just grab the BKB now, which is perfect, because Scotty helped with the damage output more at that last fight, and now he can go back to that tank ability, the BKB.
Yep.
Now he's terrifying.
Sold the drums.
He has no buyback, though.
Especially as the fight might break out in approximately 20 seconds or so, when they realize, both teams realize Roshan's up. There's a Hawk scouting out. The Sunstrike just missed the fact that Roshan's up. Like how both teams have wards sort of just on the entrance to Roshan. The Radiant.
Can you imagine if they actually managed to grab this on the Radiant side? Don't, like, if they get this on top of Yamate or the Juggernaut, this whole game is just flipped over right now.
Yeah, they've come back from a 15k net worth deficit and it's now only sitting at 6k. Well, 7k maybe.
What happened? No, I guess like the Nightstalker's starting to fall off a little bit. He's gone for this Blink Dagger. He's spot out right now. I wonder if they think it's two illusions. That is hilarious.
Well, that's exactly what you'd think, isn't it?
Yeah.
Interesting. No, they're not going to fall for the bait anyway, so. So all ultimates are online. Juggernaut, he's so close to that worth now. What is Nightstalker doing? He's just sitting there like... Yeah, you wanna get me? Yo, on! I've got Spectre to back me up. Plus a Sunstrike, maybe. A Spirit gets the mech.
Pretty funny. There was a Sunstrike near the pit and Zach's trying to kill the Hawk. Because he knows that there's a Hawk sitting there, but he missed it. Aiming Sunstrike up on the cliff.
This is Roshan. Okay, the Tornado is just gonna do the job. Roshan's got the cheese, being the third one, so, you know, even
bigger
deal.
Look at this, though. They're getting the wards, they know. And they're well aware they just give away the fact that they're gonna set up a trap. Not only they just smoke for their own to hide underneath from the Hawk.
Speaking of smoke, though, the Radiant's going to go leading forward with the Disruptor. They do see the Forge Spirits. Oh, who's going?
The Blink Vacuum.
Oh, they know. Oh, do they know they're there? They suspect the Blink forward from the Wind Ranger. Gonna have to use that BKB. Gonna fight up against the Invoke, but that's forcing him out of this fight. Forced to use the invisibility, and now the Spectre haunting in, chasing after the Disruptor. So that's the first casualty of this fight. And no one very low on WG, actually. So the BKB comes out from Juggernaut, forced to use it just so he could run away from his own illusion. Questionable BKB uses, but he didn't want to get silenced or anything. And that BKB is going to wear off in just a second now. The chase continues. They're going to blink on forward. Great Shackles. Now the kick catching out three people. And the silence is going to silence up the Night Stalker. The Rolling Boulder is not going to connect. This Juggernaut keeps getting slowed by the Skadi of his illusions. And now the Meatball has to push back the Vacuum. Catching up three heroes for the Roar. But still, the Juggernaut is dead. The Beastmaster is going to fall very shortly. This is a great fight for WG Unity. They're going to take out all five heroes of Tearing. And now they can forget about Roshan if they want. They could just push on the high ground, maybe force out some buybacks, which they will most certainly do here. Juggernaut buys back Beastmaster and the Wind Ranger. That's three buybacks. Fortification comes out, and now Unity, I think they're just going to get out.
Radiant's middle barracks are under attack. Oh, it's painful. He's a buyback, three heroes, and they just run away, but that's what you got to do. Sick. This is probably the best spot on the entire map for them to fight. It was only a single man vacuum wall, but it was right here. Cut off so left there, a couple heroes over here. Obviously having the Night Stalker means that they get this great peripheral vision, whereas when you're on the Radiant side, you're dealing with not only the trees, you're dealing with the high grounds, the low ground, so their vision was like just little pockets and spots.
Yeah.
Whereas Warriors Gaming were able to just completely set up whatever they wanted.
Actually, to be honest, I thought when the fight first started out, I thought it was going to go pretty well for Tearing, just because the Wind Ranger managed to focus on the Invoker and force him away from the fight, so they didn't have his spells, but the ball did a lot of work. That Juggernaut illusion with the Skadi. Regeneration. Roshan.
Yeah, that's the big thing, right? It's just Rush right now.
Haunt is back up again. Finger of Death in 3 seconds, so all ultimates for everyone. Ready for the go. They just go for it, right? They can take it so quickly. The Radiant, they actually have to move right now if they want to try and stop this happening, but Nightstalker's going to try and zone them out. Keep up vision for his team with that Axe. He's got the gem as well.
They're taking their time though. Like, this rush isn't dropping that fast. Like, they're really bringing us. No, they have the gem. Oh, they don't want to go without it, but so long.
Oh, this is dangerous. Tearing, I think they're just going to lose the Roshan. They smoke up now, they're going to move in, but it's going to be way too late for them. 1,000 hit points left on Roshan, it's going to start falling. That's the Aegis on the ground. Pick up the Spectre. Cheese picked up as well, I think. Tearing, they're going to just keep going for this. Looks like they're just going to go YOLO and try and pick off some stragglers. But cheese? Okay, who picked up the cheese? Was that on the courier?
I think that Night Stalker had it.
Okay, I didn't see that, but the move on forward, the Hex, the BKB didn't come off in time, and now Invoke is just going to go invisible. That's also the BKB from the Juggernaut, looking to use that Omni Slash, the wall goes down, there are some illusions now. Wind Ranger, those hit pretty damn hard, the Healing Ward comes out, the Spin, and Juggernaut's just going to get out of it. No way to cancel that, but they're chasing for more, the Vacuum back, it's going to be the death, actually. Beastmaster died to the Spectre, and now Spectre's going to get a second kill now on the Disruptor. They chase forward, this is a Night Stalker, remember, he moves fast during nighttime. And Juggernaut's actually got to be careful here. They're pinging him out. They want to try and jump on him. Lion's got that Blink Dagger, but it's off cooldown. On cooldown, even. Juggernaut is going to spin to stop the slow. Night Stalker silenced up by the boulder.
And while the creeps are coming mid, they can just rotate bot and take this tower out.
I don't think there's anything Tearing can do. I think they're just gonna have to give this up. The Shackle does come through, but the Blink forward, the finger onto the Wind Rage, she's down very low, she just gets blown up. The Meteor is gonna be the thing that finishes her off, but she's got no buyback earlier on. Now the Sunstrike hits the Juggernaut, Cold Snap up. He doesn't have the spin because he's silenced. He's gonna use it now. The kick only hitting the Night Stalker. Actually, also caught the Spectre on the back lines, but...
Yeah, that was kind of a big mistake from Yamate. I know what he was thinking is that if the Shackle doesn't land, I'm not going to BKB, but the line there, you don't really have a choice. If you're going to blink in and make the play, it doesn't matter if the Shackle's going to land or not. You have to BKB, or you get hexed and died immediately, so... Underclass Spectre.
And now the ice wall gonna go down on top of the vacuum. Oh, that's a big kill. The wall roll does come out, and Seonix, he's trying to do what he can to kill off the invoker, but the Omni Slash bouncing around. There are illusions, there are creeps to soak up this sort of damage. He's gonna spin to try and get himself out of here, but the physical damage more than enough, and I think this might just be GG. There we go. Yamate calls it for game number one in this best of three. But 12-34, I don't really think that scoreline is comparable to how this game actually was in the end.
True. And like, this game I think should have ended. I would be very demoralized if I was carrying. It looked totally wrecked. Like, after about the 8-minute mark, it seemed like Warriors Gaming had total and utter control of the game. But then there was that sudden bounce back in the middle of the game where they were all of a sudden right back into it. So, feeling a little bit better about that, I would imagine, going into game number two and